go inside into the process of reincarnation. Sometimes, as an individual, you carry the wounds of the others. What does this mean? Another person's wound simply refers to their thought patterns that we adopt. We go on adopting the thought patterns of the others, and these become wounds in our lives. If we can so easily accept someone's wounds, then why is it difficult to accept our own Buddhahood? Obviously, this comes as a question. It is a complicated one, but if you are ready to understand, I am here to explain. Everybody is carrying in one way or the other the wounds of the others. In the first place, we are living in a society where anger, hate, jealousy, all happen. We enjoy to hurt others. That is the superficial level which can be understood very easily. But there are subtle levels also which we cannot understand. You see jealousy all around, you see hate all around, you see anger all around, you see people enjoy hurting the others. These we can understand. But what about the subtle levels? And what are these subtle levels? There are so-called religious priests and preceptors who go on creating the feeling of guilt in you. They create the guilt around the body, create the guilt around sex. These are natural. It is very natural for a child to get sensations when he wants to explore his body. But it is considered as a sin. These so-called saints, they go on creating guilt in you, who condemn you to be a sinner. They are giving you an idea which will create misery around you. In order to bring about change, the entire foundation on which life is based is to change. The only foundation, the pillar of life, is compassion. Karuna hi jivan ka aadhar hai. Compassion is the only foundation of life. Compassion is reformed love. When love is freed out of passion, it is compassion. It is the concern and care, the solitary pillar. And Buddha emphasized on karuna alone. People should be sympathetic. People are sympathetic only when there is pleasure and joy and rejoicing. Because by your sympathy, you are nourishing. Nourishing people's joy, don't nourish their sadness and their misery. Be compassionate when they are miserable. Make it clear that this misery is chosen by the person himself. Misery is not, you have chosen. Instead of being happy, you choose to be miserable. Whenever any circumstance and situation comes, we have two options, either to accept it or not to accept it. The moment you accept it, you cannot be miserable because you have accepted it willingly. So on the deeper level, perhaps they need to go a little more. The very idea of reincarnation, which has arisen in all the Eastern religions, is that self goes on moving from one body to another body. This is the general conception of reincarnation. That soul goes on moving from one body to another, from one life to another. This idea does not exist in the religions that emerged out of Judaism, Christianity and Islam. But now even psychiatrists are finding that it seems to be true. People can remember their past lives. The idea of reincarnation is gaining ground now. The entire idea of reincarnation is misconception, and I had spoken in the first talk that it is misconception because we do not know if it is a myth or a reality. It is true. When a person dies, his being becomes part of the whole. Just as when you demolish an existing structure on a piece of land, the space, because of the boundaries of the structure being removed, becomes part of the whole. It was already always part of the whole. But because this land, this particular piece was occupied by you, you created a structure according to your own. Just as the space, the being that you, the portion of the being that you occupy, the space, you designed it according to you. The deco, you decide according to you. When someone else comes in the same space, he designs it according to his liking. When a person dies, his being becomes the part of the whole, merges with the whole. Whether he was a sinner or a saint, it does not matter. In the structure that you occupied, there was a kitchen space, a restroom space, bedroom space, and living room space. In a normal situation, if I ask you to go and eat in the restroom, you would not do that. You would immediately say, "What nonsense am I talking about?" So that is considered as an area which is condemned. There are certain things, certain activities we perform there, but not everything there. There is a specific areas for each group. So in a way you can say, you can understand the concept of the sinner and saint. So the moment that the structure is demolished, all this space becomes one. There is no distinction between the restroom area and the bedroom area or the kitchen area. When someone else or a new planner comes and designs the structure again, it may be possible on the space which was previously occupied by the restroom, that's where you may have your prayer room established. whether he was a sinner or a saint does not matter, but he had also something called the mind, the memory. In the past, the information was not available, but now it is available. We can explain memory as the aggregate of thoughts and thought waves. That is what the memory is. Thoughts accumulated and thought waves. And that is where, on many points, I have found Gautam Buddha to be far ahead of his time. It was Gautam Buddha who had given these hints, but he could not provide any scientific evidences. There was nothing available to say, as I am explaining, using certain examples which make it easy for you to understand. He said that when a person dies, his memory travels to the new womb. Not only his memory, it gets muddled with the memory of the others also. So it's a muddled form, the memory enters the new womb, not the self. And we now understand it, that when you are dying, you will leave memories all around in the air. And if you have been miserable, all your miseries will find some locations. They will enter into some other memory systems. Either they will enter totally into a single womb, or partially. That is how somebody remembers one's past. It is not yours. It is somebody else's mind that you have inherited. This happens because you are unconscious. Most people do not remember because they have got the whole lump, the whole heritage of a single individual memory system. They may have got fragments from here and there, and those fragments create your system of misery. All these people who have died on the earth have died in a state of misery. No one enters into death consciously, joyfully. Everyone enters into death out of fear. All these people who have died on the earth have died in misery. Very few people die out of joy. Very people have died with the realization of the no mind. They have experienced the no mind, the empty space when there is no thought. Then they simply disperse into the universe, dissolve. They do not have any mind and they do not have any memory system left. They have already dissolved in their meditation. All the hate, anger, jealousy, hatred, misery, all these have been dissolved through the meditation. The mind has attained to that serenity. That is why the enlightened person is never born. Now it happens. Someone comes to a master with certain wish to be fulfilled, certain desire to be fulfilled. Master is not lost in his own thought process. So when something is told to him, simply closes his eyes and repeats the matter, broadcasts to the cosmos. The prayer is finished. Because of the purity of that, the message is released, broadcast in the cosmos, and immediately the response comes in that it is accepted. It is accepted that it is finished, and it is bound to happen. So when there is no thought, you have dissolved all your issues out of meditation. It is like the bottle has been sterilized. The mind is sterilized. Now there is no contamination of its own. Whatsoever you will put into it will remain forever. But there are unenlightened people. They go on throwing out their misery, their thought process onto the others. So when you are speaking, you should speak out of your compassion, out of your empty space. So whatsoever will be released, it will be of tremendous benefit to the others. It will have the capacity to transform the others. When you go on reading those posts, those messages, those passages, they in the process create a groove into your consciousness. Something begins to change. But when somebody is unenlightened, he goes on throwing out his garbage. Then you know there is a system of disposing of the garbage. You separate it and dispose of it accordingly. If someone does not know, he may not know how to dispose of the garbage, and that creates a serious problem. Therefore, with death, all kind of misery patterns are thrown. Just as riches attract more riches, misery attracts more misery. If you are miserable, then from miles and miles away, misery will travel to you. You are the right vehicle to carry on the misery. And this is a very subtle or invisible phenomenon that you cannot see, but it happens. These vibrations travel like radio waves. They are traveling around you. You do not hear them. Once you have the right instrument to receive them, immediately they become available to you. Even before the radio was there, these waves were traveling towards you. There is no incarnation, but misery incarnates. Wounds of the millions of people are moving around you just in search of somebody who is willing to be miserable. You know that whenever you meet someone, he has nothing else but to throw his misery into you. And you are ready. You sympathize with the person, and in that very process, you have absorbed a part of that, knowingly or unknowingly. Now it will become your wound and your thought patterns, and you will intellect out of that. The blissful does not leave any trace. The man of awakening dies the way a bird moves in the sky. Bird lays, stretches wings, and floats in the sky, and it does not leave any track or path. The sky remains empty. Blissfulness moves without making any trace. That is why you do not get any inheritance from the Buddhas. They simply disappear, and all kinds of idiots, retarded people, go on reincarnating in their memory, and it becomes every day thicker and thicker. Today perhaps it has come to the point to be understood and to be dissolved. Otherwise it is too thick to allow you to live, to allow you to laugh. Your own consciousness has no wounds. Your own consciousness knows nothing of the memory. Your own consciousness is innocent, utterly blissful. To bring you in touch with your own consciousness, every effort is made to detract you from the mind. Efforts are made. Mind contains all memory, all your wounds, and it goes on creating wounds in such a way that unless you are more, you will not even find how to create them. All your miseries are so superficial, and most fundamentally, they are all borrowed. Remember this. And everybody is giving his misery to everybody else he comes in contact with. People are talking continuously about their miseries, about their pains, about their troubles, about their conflicts. Have you ever heard anybody talking about their joyous moments, about his dance and song, about his silence and blissfulness? No, you have never heard that. No, but, and even if somebody talks about these, you do not enjoy, you do not rejoice, you feel bored. It creates boredom. When somebody starts explaining about his misery, his conflict, his problems in life, you find interest into it and you listen to it. Nobody talks about these things. People go on sharing all their wounds, and whatever you are talking about your misery, and whenever you are talking about your misery to someone, without your knowing, you are transferring a miserable pattern into the other. The person may be thinking that he is listening to you, but he is also gathering, catching the vibes of misery, the wounds. They will become the part of his own. So without awakening, when you go on helping the people in many kind of things that we do, we try to help the others psychologically or other ways and means, you are becoming a garbage bin. You are catching the vibes of the misery and the wounds of the others. When I say that you carry other people's wounds, I mean your own consciousness has no wounds. If everybody becomes alert and meditative, there will be no wounds, no misery in the world. They will simply vanish, simply dissolve. They will not find any house, any shelter. This is possible. If it is possible for me, it is certainly possible for everybody else. And this is the reason, when you come to me and You are not dumping your misery into me because I have such a efficient drainage system. Oh, garbage disposal system, that whatsoever you try to throw into me, I turn on my exhaust and let it disappear, let it decompose and become useful and beneficial for the humanity. You know, these days the smart cities are being built. They have a garbage disposal system where there are underground channels. When whatsoever garbage you throw, it sorts out itself and goes into the various channels. It is undergoes the process and it becomes the liquid petroleum gas or the fertilizer or something else. So when you come and narrate your misery, I have put on my exhaust fan because there will be, when you are, I am talking to you, there just as when you are cooking, you put on your exhaust fan, otherwise that smell of cooking will remain inside the enclosed area. So as soon as I put on my exhaust fan and you go on telling me anything, so when you leave, you are unburdened. But you have not learned the art of unburdening yourself. The moment you learn the art of unburdening yourself, disposing of your wounds, your sufferings, your language of wounds, miseries, something begins to happen. We accept someone else's wounds very easily, but we do not understand, do not accept our own Buddhahood. You can accept somebody's wounds because you already have wounds. You already have traces of misery, and misery attracts misery. You understand the language of wounds, misery, suffering, etc. So they go on accumulating. Reincarnation, if there is a witnessing in us, then we plug it in to move to the same witnessing energy, then something begins to happen. If you plug in into the process of witnessing to the same witnessing energy, it's not that I have that witnessing energy, you too have, then it would be easy for your consciousness to remain pure. It is not that you are plugged into it and you are no more. The dispersion is so intimate, so ultimate, that first your personality has to disappear, then your individuality has to disappear, then what remains thereafter is pure existence. It makes one feel a little worried and concerned because you do not know, you do not have experienced your being, your emptiness. Just think of a moment. Before this life you were not. Was there any trouble? Was there any anxiety in you? After this life, you will not be again. What is the fear? there will be silence and peace. In the same space where anxiety, tensions and anguish flourish, they all will have melted. Just the wee, a dewdrop disappears into the ocean. Therefore, Zen, do not teach self-realization. Self-realization is as much as a lower goal. Instead, they teach the ultimate no-self-realization, or realization that is disappearing into the whole is the final peace. Your very being is an anxiety, and whatever level you are, some misery will remain. You are anxiety. And if you want your anxiety to disappear, you have to be ready to disappear yourself. As long as you remain, your misery, your anxiety will remain. Evolution is not something discovered by Charles Darwin. Evolution is an Eastern concept discovered by the mystics, and in the East, they have really gone deeper. Charles Darwin is still superficial. He thought that man has come from monkeys, and he was laughed at all over the world. The idea looks strange, but mystics' idea does not look strange. He does not say that man came from monkeys. Instead, he says that the essence of consciousness has passed through many forms, and it has passed through the forms of monkeys as well. Not every man has come to be a man from being a monkey. Remember that. Not every man has come to be a man from being a monkey. Different people have traveled different lines of evolution. This is so. All are coming from different animals, and that is one of the reasons why they are so, there is inequality. A man who is coming from monkey is bound to carry some traits, some characteristics of monkeys. Another man coming from horses will have different characteristics, and then you look at the people around, you will find that they have different characters. There are millions of animals in the world, and every person has moved through various forms. It is not a highway with the whole of humanity coming from the same source. If that was the case, all people must have been equal. Somebody is a genius, whereas the next one is born idiot. Certainly they are coming from different sources, and when they come from the different sources, they have different level of consciousness. Gautam Buddha himself remembers his past life. In one life he says he was an elephant, and after the life of the elephant he was born as a man. People are coming with different sources for different reasons. The theory of reincarnation is basically more scientific approach to evolution than that explained by Charles Darwin. It is very well known that different animals have different characteristics. When you see a cat resting, observe it. Cat is very relaxed, so relaxed you see her stretching her limbs, but she's alert. So alert if a slight voice which is with the low decibels is heard by the cat. It opens its eyes and then closes it back. It is totally relaxed and yet still moment to moment away. This is the characteristic. So on and so forth, different animals have different characteristics. The theory of reincarnation is more scientific approach to evolution than propounded by Charles Darwin, saying that man evolved out of monkeys. A person who is coming from the body of an elephant into the body of a man will have a tremendous memory. Elephant is one of the most sensitive animals. It has the quality to discern the dangers and its move is accordingly. When I was small, I had been told fading memories of there. I traveled with my grandfather, the Sufi master. He decided to take a group of people through those places where, in according to Hindu scripture, Ram lived in exile. So it was forest we had to go through, riding the elephant back. And it is said that we must come out of the forest before the sun set. After that, the moment there is dark, there is a danger of wild animals. So it happened we got delayed in coming out. All of us were riding the elephant. It was dark, we could not see anything. So the elephant is trying to, the elephant owner, the driver, was trying to force the elephant to move, but elephant was not moving. Instead, when he was forced too much, he lifted his front feet and started to create the noise. At this, the driver said, there seems to be some danger. Otherwise, the elephant would not see that, behave in such a manner. So some of the people got down and they tried to create some light, and they realized in front was a deep precipice valley. And if the elephant has moved one step forward, it would have fallen into that, and with that everybody would have fallen and died. It is the great quality of elephant to discern the fear. Whereas I explained to you the quality of the cat. Cat always sits down on an area where there is a negative energy, and it transforms the negative energy into the positive energy. So when people are sick, and if they keep cat as a pet, and they carry the cat with them, and put the cat onto their lap, the cat will feed onto the negative energy and transformed into the positive energy. On the contrary, dog sits down on a place where there is a positive energy. It does not transform that positive energy into negative energy, but it sits down, it smells and sits down on a place where there is a positive energy. That's why you would find the dogs behave in a different manner when they are trying to sit down, and cats move in a different way when they are going to sit down. These are the different characteristics. If you have evolved out of a cat, your characteristic will be different. If you evolve out of an elephant, so where does the Charles Darwin theory that each one of us have evolved out of monkey? It is the impressions of the last birth from where you have come that carries the impressions in you. A person who is coming from the body of an elephant into the body of a man will have a tremendous memory. In the same way, all the animals have their own specific qualities and talents. I am saying this for the first time, that every human being has come from a different animal, different source. Charles Darwin's idea that we have come from monkeys is wrong. If it was so, then all will show some kind of characteristics, but it is not so. Monkeys, that is why we use the word monkey, the good. A dog can be born as a human being or may go through a fewer other life forms, may become a lion, may become a deer, and then becomes a human being. It will carry all those memories into it. It carries a certain amount of memory into it. Darwin's idea is right, but not in details. In the details, it has not been able to work out. I agree with him on this essential point that man has evolved out of animal. But I do not agree that all human beings evolved out of the same source. Monkeys, apes, or chimpanzees. Human beings have come from all different directions. It is a gathering of all kind of animals, and if you watch people, you can find from where each person is coming. Just a little watchfulness, just a little watchfulness is needed. Alertness, and you will feel that this man seems to be related to a certain species. The moment the child is born, you think it is the beginning of life. That is not true. The moment an old man dies, you think that is end of life. This too is not true. Life is far bigger than the birth and death. Birth and death are the temporary halting spaces or the resting points, when the life goes on beyond the birth and death. Birth and death are not two ends of life. Many births and many deaths happen within a life. Just as during this life of 70 years, the childhood died in you. The first you were born as a baby, then baby died, you become a child, the child died, you became a teenage. But the memories of the childhood, the memories of the teenage remained in you and you carried on. Life itself has no beginning, no end. Life and eternity are equivalent to one another. Life begins at the point of your life's death. Then you die on one side, one chapter of life, which people think was your whole life, is closed. It was only a chapter in a book, which has infinite chapters. One chapter closes, but the book is not closed as yet. Just turn the page and another chapter begins. The person dying starts visualizing his next life. This is a human fact because it happens before the chapter closes. Buddha had a word for it and he calls it tanha. Literally it means the desire. But metaphorically, it means the whole life of desire. All these things happened, frustrations, fulfillments, disappointments, successes, failures. But all this happened within a certain area you can call design. The dying man has to see the whole of it before he moves on further. Just to recollect, because the body is going, the mind is not going to be with him. The brain is not going to be with him, but the desires released from the mind will cling to the soul. And this desire will decide his future life. Whatever has remained unfulfilled will move towards that target, will move towards the next life. Your life begins far back before your birth, before your mother's impregnation, further back in your past life's ends. That end is the beginning of this life. One chapter closes, another opens. Now, how this new life will be in 99% determined by the last moment of your death, last moment of your death. What you collected, what you have brought with you like a seed, that seed will become a tree, tree will bear fruits, it will bring flowers, and whatever happens to it, you cannot read it in the seed form, but seed carries the entire blueprint of the tree. If a person dies fully alert, seeing the whole terrain, he has passed. And seeing the whole stupidity of it, he is born with a sharpness, with an intelligence, with a courage. It is not something he does listening. There are different religions of the world. They carry a different kind of ideas about incarnation. I will leave that.